You're listening to the audio production of The Listening Road, One Man's Ride Across America to Start Conversations About God, by Neil Tomba, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author.
Chapter 1, The 18-Year Dream. People ask me today how long it took to ride my bicycle across America. I just grin and say, 18 years. That's how long it took me to work through the obstacles that kept me from taking time off work to make a long cross-country trip happen. The trip had sounded like an amazing adventure from the get-go, and I knew it would have purpose, too. I dreamed of meeting people and having significant conversations with them about who they were and what mattered most in their lives. But something always got in the way. See, when I was growing up, my dad taught me to keep my head down and be a hard charger. Riding a bicycle was play, and he was all about work, work, work. In my dad's worldview, there wasn't a lot of room for margins. Certainly not for taking time off work to go on long bike rides or to have deeper conversations with people, particularly folks you didn't even know. That mindset stuck with me long into my adulthood. It was right about the time I became senior pastor of Northwest Bible Church in Dallas in 2001 that my dream of riding a bike cross-country was born. Our church ran a two-week camp each summer in Colorado, and part of my job was to lead it. It was a blast. We rode mountain bikes, and I led hikes. I felt like I was a kid who was working really hard at play. One afternoon, I was riding my mountain bike on the epic Monarch Crest Trail when I rode through a beautiful section of woods that I'd ridden through more than once. It was a shortcut to get back to the cabin we were staying at. The trail was padded with pine straw, and after coasting through the trees, I emerged onto a rough gravel road. There lay a pond and a fish hatchery, and a family was there with their fly rods out catching fish. This dad and mom and a little boy and a girl captured my attention. The area was so beautiful and so far off the main road that I wondered how they found this place and if they came here often. That made me think more about their stories. I began to think about countless conversations I'd had at times like this, and I really wanted to stop and talk with them. I didn't even realize I was slowing down as I drew closer. I just felt the longing to talk with them, and not only that, but to go across the whole country having conversations with all kinds of people about who they are and what matters in their lives. I never forgot that moment. That's when the dream was born. But I toyed with that dream for 18 years because I didn't give myself permission to pursue it at first. See, in my mind, riding a bike was still play, and I needed to work. Three things became catalysts for change in my dream. First, around 7 years ago, when I was 51, doctors discovered a tumor in my small intestine. They suspected cancer, so I had the tumor removed along with my ileocecal valve, the one between the small and the large intestine. Fortunately, the tumor wasn't cancerous, but a doctor told me, "Neil, you could have died from this." I'd felt a small brush with my own mortality then, and I thought, some things need to change. Maybe I could take time for play after all. Maybe I could take time for passions that aren't work. Second, I'd always wanted to do a half Ironman, which involves swimming, biking, and running. But training for one had always felt like play, so it never happened. After my surgery, I set a goal: do a half Ironman. 13 months after the surgery, I finished the race. My three daughters were grown by then, and for years I'd been hearing about the Leadville 100. It's a long mountain bike race held each year on rugged trails and dirt roads through the heart of Colorado's Rocky Mountains. I'd always wanted to attempt that, but I'd felt too guilty about the time commitment required for training and travel. The race starts at 10,000 feet and ascends to 12,400 feet, and it requires more training than even a half Ironman. But one of my daughters, Cherie, had trained for the race and asked me to be on her pit crew. I'd gone to support her, and while I was there, I looked around and said, you know, I think I could do this. I was hooked. I trained and soon set out on my first attempt. The race was so hard. The first two times I tried, I didn't make it to the finish line. But the third time I did. That became the second catalyst and got me thinking, if I can ride a mountain bike over the Leadville 100, I bet I can ride a road bike across America. About then, the leadership team at my church started working on a new vision in which we encourage people in our congregation to get outside the walls of the church, have more conversations about Jesus with neighbors, and seek more opportunities to serve people of our city. This became the third catalyst. America seems so divided over people's opinions about everything. We wanted to learn to talk about the most important things in a way that made people feel respected, heard, and valued. Too often, I'd seen or been a part of conversations where neither person was truly listening to the other, and I suspect that we were all suffering from a chronic lack of genuine listening. It seemed increasingly important to figure out how to do this, how to invite people instead of just shutting the door in their faces. And maybe this idea that wouldn't go away was more than an irresponsible dream. One of the leaders in our church is a young attorney and entrepreneur named Reese. In talking to him and the team about our church's vision, I mentioned my dream of riding my bike across the country and how it might relate to our church's overall vision. Reese got really excited. "You need to do this, Neil," he said. "Do it now and do it in a big way." Reese encouraged me to think far bigger than I had before. I'd imagined doing this ride in a small way with just me on my bike following my wife in a van. But Reese insisted I ride with a team of people to help me go faster, farther. He also said that lots of other people should hear about our trip. That meant we needed to document every conversation I had with a film crew, which he could arrange for me. With Reese's help, my dream of a coast-to-coast ride grew some wings. A team came together very quickly, almost miraculously. One longtime friend in his mid-50s, Paul, was heading toward early retirement and insisted he come along as support staff. Another friend in his 50s, Jeff, grew so excited about the trip that he actually quit his job so he could help. A mountain biking buddy of mine, Wes, was an experienced cyclist and immediately volunteered to become part of my riding team. I talked to my daughter Cherie about coaching me and designing a training plan. A woman in her early 30s, Caroline, worked in our sports and recreation ministry at the church. Her story of losing 50 pounds while preparing for a half Ironman impressed us all and proved her drive. She was a novice biker, but she agreed to train with Cherie so she could be one of the three cyclists who would ride all the way cross country. Two missionaries who had been supported by our church for more than 40 years, Glenn and Judy, offered to drive a support vehicle. Reese's colleague John, a professional videographer and director, was eager to come and film the project, and John had an assistant, James, who could help for 2 weeks. A Chinese seminary student, Christine, could assist for the remainder of the trip, and another student, Joy, from India, agreed to be a driver for a few weeks. Yuna, a Tongan American, would also be a driver along with Sarah, an administrator at our church. My wife, Vila, rounded out the team. We started to have monthly meetings to pray about the trip and work out the logistics of traveling and everyone being away from home for more than a month. One of the biggest questions I had privately was whether anybody on the road would actually talk to me, particularly on camera. I wasn't a professional journalist. I'd never interviewed people other than our church members. I was worried about my lack of experience, but I eventually decided that I had to put anxiety out of my mind. I wanted the conversations to be real, not staged or fake. They had to be authentic dialogues. What else could I do except go ask people if they wanted to talk and then just do it? I started to train for the trip in earnest. I was eating healthy. I didn't have any nagging injuries. I began riding anywhere from 150 to 200 miles each week, doing 20-mile rides several times throughout the week, and 75 to 100 miles each Saturday. After I'd finish a ride, I'd climb off my bike and immediately do a set of 50 push-ups. Plenty of days, I'd tack on two additional sets of 25. I used a power meter and a computer program on my bike to measure something called functional threshold power, FTP, so I could analyze my workouts and my endurance performance ability. One day, I did a 210-mile ride to raise awareness about our trip. The more I trained, the stronger I became. One by one, every component of our trip came together. Team members, finances, physical ability, transportation, everything. The momentum was gaining. The dream was actually going to happen. 2 weeks before the start date of our trip, I decided to do an evening ride with a group of 50 people from a local bike shop. Despite the fact that my daughter, who had been coaching me, didn't want me to do a group ride this close to start time. It was a beautiful Dallas evening, 85 degrees out, sunny and still light. We were set to ride loops around White Rock Lake. Normally on rides like these, I rode as hard as I could near the front of the pack, but that evening I told myself to go more slowly. I hung near the back of the lead group with about 8 riders ahead of me. A larger bunch of riders followed us. The ride started perfectly. We rode to the lake and started to make the loops. I felt stronger than I'd ever felt. Indestructible. But as we rounded a corner and went into a slight downhill at the bottom of the dip, I hit a bump. We were flying along at about 30 miles per hour, and when I hit the bump, the chain popped off my front sprocket. We were heading uphill by then, and in that exact moment when I pressed hard on my pedal, I encountered no resistance thanks to my unattached chain. My foot slipped off my pedal, the bike wobbled, and my back wheel slid out from underneath me. Suddenly, I was going down. Hard. My bike slid out to the left, the entire right side of my body aimed toward the pavement. I felt one leg scrape the ground first, then my arm slammed against the road, then my hip. For a moment, everything was confusion and chaos. I sensed tumbling, grinding, skin ripping, and incredibly sharp pain. When my bike finally stopped moving, all I could do was lie on the pavement, trying to suck in enough air to breathe. I saw blood, lots of blood. My blood coming from at least 5 brand new ragged openings on my body. Huge sections of my skin were badly road burned. The rush of pain to my brain was so unbearable I thought I was going to pass out. The screaming started once I could suck in enough air to make a sustained sound. That's when the truth of what had just happened hit me hard. All along in the training, I'd been asking myself if I had what it would take to make this trip. A huge challenge lay before me, and I wondered if I could make it the whole way across the country. I'd been wondering how the trip would change me in the process. Now we were 2 weeks away from the date we were set to leave, and this challenge had already defeated me. The challenge was already over. I wasn't even going to be able to start. Chapter 2, Desperate Dependence. I did not want to be defeated. Certainly not yet. I lay on the road for a few split seconds, tangled in the mess of my bicycle. Other bicyclists screeched to a stop around me, shouting their concerns. Was I okay? Did I want an ambulance? Was I dead? Slowly, I untangled myself, sat upright, and took stock of my wounds. My elbow dripped blood. A fist-sized hole had been ripped from the fabric of my jersey near my shoulder, and my skin showed through, raw and bleeding. I had large swaths of road rash on my right hip, quadricep, knee, and ankle with dirt and bits of black asphalt embedded in what remained of my skin. The middle of each gash was mostly red, like uncooked hamburger, while the circumference of several...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.